It appears there is a new herpes vaccine on the horizon that addresses HSV2 and potentially HSV1. I know they utilize the mRNA vaccine. I know mRNA is like a genetic, it's basically addressing a disease from a genetic standpoint. I know they did this with cancer. This mRNA treatment or mRNA phase of addressing diseases, any mRNA vaccine, it's opened the door to basically curing or addressing a lot of diseases and infections and ailments, like a lot of stuff. They're using mRNA or genetic therapy, any type of gene therapy, to address, you know, all types of cancers. And here it looks like some STD, STI, all type of like maybe other diseases people are born with, not just developed. And I think this is a great discovery, and it's basically a great find. It's like, you know, it's almost, it's like a godsend basically, because with the mRNA, from using from an mRNA perspective, you can use a person's genes and as well as the genes of the virus and kind of address how an infection occurs. You can pinpoint where it's going to occur, and you can attack it where it's most, where the cure is most effective, or where that virus or ailment is most vulnerable, right? Since cancer is not a virus, cancer is more of a, your cells going wild. But yeah, I think this mRNA is almost like a, it's godsend. It's like you're finding a gem as far as addressing, I mean, this one basic type of research is just addressing all types of sicknesses. So in this case, it's looking at the herpes virus. So back in December, it was announced that the first test subject was dosed in the first in-human phase 1 clinical research study with something called BNT-163. So this herpes simplex virus, HSV vaccine, it's used for prevention of genital lesions caused by HSV2 and potentially HSV1. So the trial is supposed to evaluate the safety, tolerability, and immunogenicity of BNT-163. So basically, the mRNA vaccine encodes three HSV glycoproteins. Looks like it takes some genes from, or some genetic material from the HSV, with the aim of helping to prevent HSV cellular entry and spread. Yeah, again, it looks like, again, it's, again, this mRNA approach, it takes, it looks at genetic material of the herpes virus and the genetic material of the patient, and kind of addresses the issue. So this kind of wants to prevent the spread and as well as counteract the immunosuppressive properties of HSV. So it also kind of blocks the herpes virus from disturbing your immune system. It's pretty exciting stuff. Like, it's kind of like a breakthrough. A lot of small breakthroughs. Well, not small, but quiet breakthroughs happening around that people aren't really aware about. Now, according to the World Health Organization, there's approximately 500 million people who are estimated to be affected by HSV2, and a lot of them have painful lesions and increased risk of meningitis and high levels of emotional distress. Yeah, I read that people who are susceptible or who catch HSV2 tends to flare up for them when they're under a lot of stress. That's why I read that a couple years back. They say basically, yeah, it's HSV2 persists lifelong in the body, and sometimes it just kind of goes dormant and hides. It's got reoccurring symptomatic outbreaks. And they say also HSV2 infection increases the risk of acquiring HIV infections by approximately threefold. So that's a co-infection of HIV and HSV2 to increase the likelihood of transmitting HIV to others. This is according to the World Health Organization. That's pretty scary. Kind of makes you, also people, those who are out there who are active doing certain things, you know, makes them want to kind of take a pause and reevaluate some things, I would think. So up to this date, there's no vaccine that's been approved for prevention of HSV up to this point. So a lot of therapies, they only kind of reduce severity and frequency. You know, you hear about, I guess, you know, pills or things like that. But this BioNTech, there's a company called BioNTech, and I think they are working with Penn University, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, it's Penn. So they basically use a placebo-controlled, observer-blinded, dose escalation phase 1 trial. And is suspected to enroll, well, they already enrolled, they enrolled 100 healthy volunteers aged 18 to 55 without any history of the symptomatic genital herpes infections. And the study consists of a first dose escalation that will focus on the safety evaluations, and they want to assess the optimal dose response in various dose levels. So I guess you're going to use various levels of this vaccine to see how the body responds. The second part of the trial is going to focus on safety and for the selected dose, and they're going to give like a more comprehensive assessment of the impact of those who have pre-existing HSV 1 and 2. So this takes the strategy is basically they want to address the disease, because a lot of medical needs in regards to HSV or herpes has been unmet. So they're using mRNA approach along with immune engineering. Yeah, again, this gene therapy or basically genetic approach to conquering diseases is just I can't find the right words anymore, but it's just like, it's almost like you've kind of hit a bullseye in some cases, right? And it's just like, it's a great find. It's a great discovery. Let's hope that there's success in this. And, you know, it's kind of like with HIV, they've been making progress. But that's more, it basically not occurring anymore. But this looks like, reminds me of that cancer cure I made a video about not too long ago, regarding a cancer vaccine that's tailored to your genes. But this is not, I mean, of course, HSV is not as severe as cancer, but it's extremely inconvenient for someone who catches it. It's a life-altering disease, and it can only partially be prevented currently. But this is basically a medical breakthrough in regards to this. With basically the teamwork of Penn University and BioNTech, they have like a collaboration, and they also have a license agreement to develop the mRNA vaccine. You know, it kind of reminds me, I don't know who's working on it, if it's all grad students, but in some cases, how much is BioNTech working on it, and how much are the graduate students or professors working on it? Because, you know, sometimes companies pay universities a huge amount of money to work on things, to do research, right? Universities get massive millions and billions of dollars to do research. And these biotech companies, I guess in this case, you know, it's a combination license agreement with the university and the biotech company. But I'm not going to call names, but we know, those of us who have experience in academia, know that there are some cases where, you know, you have students and professors heavily working on the research and the company not really, basically the company gives a lot of financial resources, but there's not a lot of manpower from the corporation side. Some of us have seen it where the manpower is on the university side. I mean, which is fine as long as they get credit, but it's interesting. Do they get any compensation for that? Maybe it's like an NIL thing. Now, I don't know. That's a whole other topic, but it could be related, right? Could be. It's interesting. So yeah, I know the University of Pennsylvania, Penn, they've licensed some intellectual property related to this BNT163 vaccine. So it's like a combination property ownership with both the corporation and the university. Actually, I just read, I was mentioning NIL or some type of compensation, but there's an article that says some of the scientists, they may receive additional financial benefits under this license in the future. Okay, but what about, I don't know, maybe it's all university employees, but I do know, we've all seen students working on things, right? Do the students get any dibs on it as well? Who knows? I don't know. Regardless, this is great news, and it's encouraging and inspiring for those who probably suffering from a severe case of HSV-1 and HSV-2. And I think this is a great breakthrough and some encouraging news for them. If they've heard of it. If they haven't, then I guess not. But hopefully this news gets out, you know, more of this news gets out. This information actually has been out, from what I see, in December, but it's kind of been a quiet thing to me. I haven't heard of it until now. But let me know your thoughts. Feel free to leave a comment. And thank you so much for listening.